I'm Kyle Meyer, and welcome back to the Best Wines Online Tasting Room. With me today is a guy by the name of Greg Sanders. Now, you may not, I mean, this guy isn't, you know, he's not on all the blogs. Your face isn't on the cover of Wine Spectator, right?
Wine Spectator's not a big lover of whole cluster fermentations.
He's not. But let me tell you something about the guy sitting next to me here. You want to talk about a guy that quietly knows a hell of a lot about Pinot Noir. This cat next to me, over the course of the last, decade, 10, 15 years, we've probably drank most of the, what people would consider the great Pinot Noirs produced in the last 20 years together.
Most of the greatest big names.
Big names, yeah, exactly. We do these fabulous tastings every year where we hunker down with a few of the really big names, and we assess the wines. I mean, it's fun, but we get a little clinical with them. We try and figure out, because this guy's mojo is, he wants to know how, the what, and why this is this way, and why this tastes this way, and why this turned out this way. It's always been your angle, and it's been a fantastic angle.
Something between an angle and an obsession, I'd have to say.
Obsession? Yeah, no, obsessions, that sounds fair.
It's just understanding where every single detail came from that led to what you have in your glass. You know, what caused this, what caused that.
Yeah.
And so trying these wines that we're trying over a long period of time to understand the aging process, to understand what it was like when it was young and what it's like now that it's old.
Right.
All those things all go together from the day that you tasted it as a grape in the vineyard until now you're tasting it in a bottle 20 years later. So.
Right. No, that's it. Now, did you hear all that? This cat has cataloged everything. It's all there. And what he's done with his own White Rose Estate, a name you may be familiar with, it's been part of the single vineyard programs of quite a few famous Oregon wineries, as well as their own estate wines that they produce with much critical acclaim, I would say at this juncture, finally, after figuring it out, right? The deal is, all that work, all that research, to me, when you brought this wine in the other day, found its way into this bottle. Would that be a fair assessment?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, this is Greg calls the wine the neoclassical objective. Let's talk about this.
What is the neoclassical objective?
What the heck is this?
Let's see, I'll start with what it is. It's a kind of a two-part objective. The first is to identify fruit and source fruit that's going to create a classic fruit type and fruit character in the wine.
Mm-hmm.
The second portion is the condition of ageability, the character of things, and the kind of condition of the wine as it ages through its process. So, starting with classic, every varietal has a certain group of fruit types that are specific to that varietal.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe in the warmer areas, say Cabernet might look more into some of the dark cherries and plums and type of warm fruit characteristics. I guess I should back up and say that there's a spectrum of fruit types that come from warm areas up to cool areas.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're all the way down here in very, very warm area, you may get as far down as a raisin, then you get down to a fig, then a prune, then a plum, then you get up into the dark cherries, light cherries. Moving up from there, you may get up into your raspberries, blackberries. Over the top, you'll be getting into oranges, lemons, and then, you know, I don't know, water at that point. So the warmer that it is during the point between veraison and harvest,
mm-hmm.
the warmer the fruit types. So with Pinot Noir, the classic fruit type, the fruit was ripened under the correct temperatures to give a great sense of Pinot Noir-ness, then you're looking for blackberries and raspberries. So every varietal has a sort of sense of itself. There's a Cabernet Sauvignon-ness, and there's a Merlot-ness, and there's a Pinot Noir-ness. And if you do the obsession thing where we've just gone and tasted Pinot after Pinot after Pinot, year after year, there's a certain field goal of classicness that gives it the sense of a classic Pinot Noir. Classic is we'll call it an empirical thing that is of subjective quality. Mm-hmm. Empirically, it's either classic or it's not, but some people may love warm, fleshy, darker fruit types. Dark cherries and light cherries, you know, as you get warmer, the concentration and the sweetness tends to follow it. So many people like a very sweet, concentrated wine that's starting to get into the dark cherries and so forth, and even into the plums and prunes and figs. But this particular style of winemaking is about looking for that classic orientation. Why? It's there's a very specific reason. It has to do with my obsession with the connection between emotion and experience. Mm-hmm. Pinot Noir, more than any other varietal, has the potential to connect emotionally to people. So my objective as a producer is to ascertain in what condition do wines typically connect emotionally to people.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, great wines can connect emotionally, and not so great wines can connect emotionally. And I don't mean not so great wines, but say for example a table wine. I always use the movie Ratatouille to kind mm-hmm. of explain what I mean by this kind of transcendent connection. So, in the movie Ratatouille, there's this food critic, and he has this experience where he tries this ratatouille. Are you familiar with the movie?
Yeah, and it brings him back to his childhood.
Just, you can see it. And so, you know, wine has that potential for people. And if you grew up in the village of Chambertin and you drank Chambertin your whole life, just like that gentleman ate ratatouille, or mm-hmm. you eat your grandmother's lasagna.
Yep.
When you try your grandma's lasagna, it has that potential for an emotional connection. So there are different kinds of emotional connection, but the one that I'm seeking here is a sort of emotional connection, almost in an artistic sense. You
mm-hmm.
know, people connect to the Pinot Noir-ness. It's a sort of strange, hard thing to explain, but usually when people have that epiphany Pinot, it's usually in this particular classic condition.
Right. Okay. So what you're saying is, like, this wine isn't necessarily the style of this wine makes people sit there and go, I had a wine like this, like 10, 15 years ago from producer X, and it was like unbelievable. And this wine shares some of those same unbelievable characteristics based on its classic.
Well, the classic, how do I say it? The classicness is specific to the temperatures, and then you have your sort of transparency, people call it transparency, your mm-hmm. your freshness, your purity of fruit. Mm-hmm. And in that condition, then you can see all the stuff underneath. And that really is what makes Pinot Noir different from the other varietals. For $15, I can buy you a Shiraz that'll whip the bottom off of any Pinot any day for, mm-hmm. you know, power and fruit. But what does Pinot have that's special? It's all of the other things, all of the floral notes, the spice components, all of the details. And it becomes very, very important to me, and in my perspective, the character of all those details coming together to create that connection emotionally. So it's the classic condition only is about removing some of the sweetness and the concentration of fruitiness and creating an environment in which you can smell the Pinot Noir-ness, and in there is that potential for an artistic emotional connection.
Right.
By
definition, does that mean it's like one of the best Pinot Noirs you can produce?
No.
Or are you merely looking?
No. It has nothing to do with best, because this isn't a qualitative thing. It's mm-hmm. it's more of a this is an alternative presentation to Pinot Noir.
Got it.
Choosing vineyards that produce fruit that's grown under the temperatures that yield a classic condition. You know, anybody can grow a classic grape. It just has to be under the correct temperatures.
Right.
So all that does is give you sort of the nest. And then the second component, which is always 100% whole cluster, old vines, that portion generates the character of things. That's very important to me. And so it's not just the fact that it has fruit in it, that it has spice in it, and that it has floral components. It's the character of all those conditions. And my experience has led me to prefer 100% whole cluster fermentations to generate the character of those details that I think connect most, are most likely to connect to people emotionally.
Yeah.
You can make a very fleshy wine, and it can be very, very pleasurable, but I don't think it has as much potential for people to connect emotionally to it. And that's really, I think, for me, that's my schnizzle.
Right.
I'm always focusing on those few experiences that you have when you try wine, and just that light goes on, and people start to talk real quickly, and they kind of, there's just a certain thing, you can see it in their eyes. I've even had a woman in the tasting room one time who smelled the wine, and she said to me, "What happened?" It's a tangible, palpable, I mean, it's a real experience, and if you present the wine in a specific format, it gives people a greater likelihood of that connection.
Yeah. Well, to your point, this isn't the inkiest wine. It's not the darkest wine. It's not the oakiest wine. Yeah, no, I know. I know it's not part of your gig. But it is one of the Pinot Noir-iest wines.
If you could give me a compliment and say, "Wow, this really tastes really Pinot Noir-y," and then all I've done is represent a history of 1,000 years of breeding.
Yeah.
In other words, I haven't done anything but figure out how to present the wine to you in exactly the manner that it was intended to be grown and vinified, so that you can at the end say, "Wow, this really tastes just like Pinot Noir." Mm-hmm.
But by the way, on a qualitative level, this flashes me back to some of those gigs that we had together.
Oh yeah, back in the
this is pretty serious wine that I think can hold its place with a lot of wines that are 3, 4, or 5 times the price from Burgundy.
Yeah. So the one thing is I don't make quality. The vineyard makes quality. All I do is try to craft the condition and the character of things. Mm-hmm. So when you pick and how you vinify, those things have a dramatic effect on the character of the way things are represented in the bottle. The quality comes from the vineyard, and you just have to do your best to present it in a fashion that you think as a producer is most appropriate.
Dude, so Greg, thanks.
My
for
pleasure.
Bringing me one of the finest Pinot Noir-iest experiences I've had in the last few years. Keep up the good work. This dude's real. This dude gets it. He's awesome.
I appreciate it.
Cheers.
That's the kind of thing to say. I appreciate it.
All right, cheers.